Imagine Brian Bulaga, but with rabies. And that's Tevin Jenkins to me. He has almost everything you could ever want in an offensive tackle, especially as a pass protector in this pass-happy era of the modern NFL. But he packages all of these skills and traits that are similar to Brian Bulaga with one of the most inherently violent playstyles to come out of college in the last few years. He's huge and strong, obviously. He's also extremely instinctive in terms of how he reads fronts and knows what to expect based on those alignments, but it's the way that he finishes every single block with borderline hatred towards defensive linemen, that's what really sets him apart from the rest of this offensive line class to me. If I was an O-line coach and you asked me who the most fun offensive lineman was to watch in this class, it wouldn't be Penei Sewell, it wouldn't be Rashawn Slater or Elijah Vera Tucker, it would without a doubt be Tevin Jenkins. His tape is pure entertainment for people that like watching big dudes in the trenches. However, the reason why he's such a good prospect to begin with is not just that size or his raw strength or that trademark aggression, it's his technique and how he uses that technique to weaponize all of his other traits. His footwork, his hand placement, his discipline with his shoulders, some of the mind games that he would play with pass rushers using some relatively advanced techniques that we'll get into later, those were all the real reasons why his pass protection efficiency numbers were so astronomically high last season. So, for the sake of breaking all that down piece by piece, I want to take you on a deep dive into Jenkins' technique by looking at how he does what's called an angle set or a kick set by most coaches, because he's about as textbook perfect as it gets in that area. Any young offensive lineman that watch this channel, and I know there are many, all of you should absolutely copy everything that Jenkins is doing here. For starters, Jenkins is phenomenal at timing the snap. He often looks like he gets to his landmarks before everyone else just on athleticism, but in reality, a big part of it is that he times the snap well enough to start before everyone else. This is a highly underrated quality in an offensive lineman, especially for a tackle, and throughout every game from Jenkins that you watch, he is consistently one of, if not the first guy off the ball on both offense and defense, and he's really, really hard to get the jump on for that reason. Secondly, beyond just being the first guy out of his stance most of the time, Jenkins' initial step in his set is always really explosive and covers a lot of ground. Some coaches teach a 6-inch first step to kind of gather themselves and then an explosive second step because they want to try to prevent guys from oversetting too much to the outside and giving up the inside. But Jenkins tends to do the opposite and get into his set more in the vein of the teachings of Bob Wiley or to a degree Howard Mudd, where that first step is huge and explosive to choke off the angle of any potential speed rush immediately in the play. And then he will come under control with smaller steps while he reads the rusher's technique. From there, the rest of the rep is all about hand usage and reaction timing and all that other stuff that we'll get into shortly, but that first step to gain ground and get to his landmark out wide is key because it takes away an easy path around the edge on a speed rush. Now, thirdly, while Jenkins is getting that explosive start in his set, even if he gets a little bit too overset to the outside, he is great at protecting himself from counter moves back inside by keeping his shoulders disciplined and as parallel to the line of scrimmage as possible, at least initially in those first few steps, obviously. What squaring up those shoulders to the line of scrimmage does is it makes it easier to use the inside hand to catch the shoulder or preferably the armpit of the edge rusher as they shoot inside. And because the torso is already turned slightly inside because the shoulders are parallel to the line, that makes it easier to just lift that inside foot off the ground, unlock the inside hip, and do what's called a power step back inside to catch that edge rusher and shut down the inside move. A power step, by the way, and I'll use this play against West Virginia as an example because you get a really good view of it, is when the offensive lineman is catching that rusher trying the inside counter, and as I said, you unlock the inside hip and you lift the foot to kind of let the pass rusher carry you inside with his momentum, and with that momentum, you step flat 90 degrees to the inside. You don't step forward, you don't step backwards, you step straight sideways. This 90-degree step creates what's called a hard shoulder for the pass rusher to get through on the inside, because you basically just wall him off and make him go around you. And when you combine that hard shoulder on the power step with Jenkins just straight up being a strong dude that's holding on for dear life by grabbing your chest pads, it's extremely, and I mean extremely, hard to get around him from this spot. Jenkins almost never makes it easy to win against him on inside counters, and if you do beat him inside, you probably really earned it, because all of those technical details that I just went over are super difficult to crack. Square shoulders in his set, strong inside punches, a really good feel for unlocking that hip and timing the power step to cut off the angle, and of course just his raw grip strength is obnoxiously good. He really does everything correct from a technical standpoint. However, what you may be wondering is, what happens if the rusher doesn't go inside? What happens if he has to handle something like a swipe move, or a cross chop, or a long arm into a rip move to the edge? How does he handle those? And that's a really good question, so I'll answer it with two different, but equally impressive techniques. The first kind of go-to technique for him when handling any move to the outside is a flash technique into a really wide punch. Again, some coaches call that type of wide punch a hug technique, others just call it a wide punch or a clamp position. It just depends on who you talk to. And what that flash into a clamp does is it completely baits the pass rusher into doing whatever Tevin wants them to do. A lot of edge rushers, honestly, they're kind of like hyenas. If you throw them some meat, they're gonna eat it. It doesn't really matter where it came from. And so if you flash that outside hand to them, most of them can't resist that fresh meat, and they're going to attack that outside hand with a swipe or a chop or something like that to go outside. If you flash inside, they'll go inside, of course, and if you keep flashing outside, they'll keep going outside. And the key after you flash that hand, whether inside or outside, is that you immediately pull it away so that they completely miss their chop or swipe or whatever move they're using, and then you come back in with a wide punch to get them in that clamp position. And once they're clamped, there's pretty much no getting out of it, especially against a guy as strong as Jenkins. When he's got you, that's kind of it, and Jenkins abused those flash techniques and wide punches to clamp down on edge rushers that, quite frankly, would just not stop taking that bait over and over again, and that was a primary reason for his statistical dominance as a pass protector. Nobody could get the edge on him because nobody could actually knock away his outside hand after he flashed it. He almost never gave it up. Now, the second technique that he uses was pretty much only busted out when rushers tried to use what's called a long arm technique into his chest. Go back to my last episode on Jalen Phillips to get a good idea of what a long arm move can accomplish and why it's done. Most of the time, when rushers used a long arm against Jenkins to try to keep themselves out of getting clamped by him, he punished that move with what's called a trap technique, or sometimes he would use another similar move called a fork technique in order to knock those long arm moves away and, more often than not, plant the pass rusher face first into the grass. I think my favorite example of that came in the Texas game, and just watch how easy Jenkins makes this look. He's very upright in his set here, almost looking kind of off balance and stiff in a way, just inviting that long arm stab into his exposed chest. He wants this 5 technique defensive end to try it again, because this was, I think, the third time in this game already that he used it against Jenkins, and at this point, Tevin had just had enough of it. He invited that long arm in, and then just as it was about to make contact, he sprung that trap and chopped it down, hence why they call it a trap technique, and now look at the compromised position this defensive end is in. He was going to put all of his body weight into that long arm stab, expecting it to land square in Jenkins' chest to catch him, but now he's got no point of contact because of that trap, so he's way off balance over his toes, and he has no way to recover. Tevin just waits for him to fall all over himself and finishes with the easy pancake, just in case he forgot what tackles eat for breakfast. These trap techniques were all over Jenkins' film, and I would say maybe half of all of his many, and I mean many, pancake blocks where he drove pass rushers into the ground were started from well-executed traps. Like I said, when it comes to intelligence and instincts and weaponizing physical gifts with technical discipline, there might not be anybody better in this entire draft class than Tevin Jenkins. I love almost everything about him, and I think he's easily worth a top 15 to 20 pick in this draft class. I know that there are some concerns about arm length that maybe possibly could necessitate a move to guard in the NFL, and we'll see what he measures in at his pro day later this month before we jump to any conclusions on that. But in terms of every other aspect of his game, he's awesome. Jenkins has so many great qualities between his athleticism, his intelligence, his leadership, and physicality that I honestly find it hard to believe that he won't be a great offensive lineman at the next level, regardless of what position he ends up at. I don't know where he's gonna go, and I don't know how high he's gonna go, but I do know that he's a damn good football player, and one of the most fun prospects to watch across all positions in this entire draft class. And for all of us, the football fans that get to watch him for the next 10 years, that entertainment value is really all that matters to me. I'll be back tomorrow with another bonus episode on a few more players that I find extraordinarily fun to watch that don't get nearly as much press as they deserve, so keep an eye out for that. And until then, cheers. Before we go, I want to take a quick second to thank our sponsor for this week, Babbel, the number one language learning app in the entire world. There's more than 10 million people right now, as I say this, learning new languages on the app, and there's a reason for that. It works. University studies have shown that just 15 hours on Babbel can be just as effective as an entire college semester's worth of language learning courses, and that's because Babbel focuses on how to use the language in real-life scenarios and conversations rather than just learning how to ask where the library is. I've always had the goal of becoming bilingual and maybe eventually trilingual because a full third of my audience is international. A lot of you guys are from Europe. I have a ton of French fans and Italian fans and German fans, so I've been slowly trying to work my way back into becoming competent in French, which, you know, if you've seen me interact with some people on Twitter in French because I'm trying to get better at it, and eventually I'm going to tackle German because I really want to be able to better communicate with my audience, especially since for so many of you, English is your second or maybe even third language. And I mean, let's be real, as the NFL becomes a more global sport, eventually there might be games played in France and Germany and Italy and all these other international stadiums. And I want to be able to bring the sport that I love to the people of those countries in any way that I can. So if you're thinking about joining me and learning a new language for 2021 for whatever reason, you can get up to a 50% discount on Babbel at that link in the description below. It's an incredible service that I highly recommend because it really, really works. Again, that is up to 50% off at that link below. Thank you again to Babbel for sponsoring this show, and I'll be back in a few days with something very different that I think you're all really going to enjoy. So until then, I'll see you later.